Right? Great. Terrific, right? Great. Welcome to day three, the final day. And our anchor for today, our moderator is Oyinda, all the way from Nigeria. Over to you, Oyinda.
Hi, everybody. I hope I'm audible. Hope you can all hear me.
Yeah, we can hear you.
I think everybody will agree that the last 3 days have been fantastic. We've had amazing performances, amazing workshops, and I think I've learned so much just from across the globe on how we're responding to what is a pandemic and what is a difficult time. But we're responding the best way we know how through love, laughter, play, and art. And we're just about to kick off our third and final day, and I'm excited to have everybody here. I think we're all on silent, so we know all the normal protocol. If at any time during presentations you have any questions that you want asked, feel free to write that in the chat box, and I'll try and follow along. And I think we're going to kick off today with what is an amazing duo. Who was here? If you were here on day one, could I get some thumbs up? Yeah? Yeah, great, I can see some thumbs. Yeah, they actually have been just set off the tone of the conference in such an amazing way 2 days ago. And we are fortunate enough to have them again with us. And they are going to be playing and just setting the tone for today. So I'm going to hand over to you, Bin and Jin. Oh, and maybe I can do a bit more of an intro and let those of you who were not here on day one have a little bit of an idea of who we've got. So Jin and Bin are one of the best Guggen. We've got some company. Gives them performers.
I'm looking now, please.
No, there I walk.
Can you hear us?
Yes.
Oh, great. So yeah, we are glad to be back again. So the song we are gonna perform today is from Japanese movie. Is from the soundtrack of a Japanese movie composed by Brazilian composer Sergio Assad. Well, we met him here in Arizona. He comes every year for his Artist in Residence program. So this song is called Farewell. So what makes this song special is that he dedicated this song to his deceased wife. So you could see from the mood of this tune, it's very somber and melancholic. We hope to use this one to also commemorate all the victims of the COVID-19. Yeah, we hope you enjoy this short piece.
Thank you.
Wow, that was amazing.
That was beautiful.
Yeah, I think we need a round of applause. Yeah, we've got some jazz fingers going on there. Stacey.
That was a good start for the meeting today.
Yeah. I don't know about you, but every time I hear them, they just have a way of just calming me. It's just such beautiful calming. I feel like we're experiencing some art in health here. I forgot to mention at the start that we may go over ever so slightly today. I know that we said that the conference was from 9 to 11 today. And that's Pacific Standard Time, I believe. So we may go over by about 5 or 10 minutes, just as it's the last day. And we want to make sure that we round up and close off, make sure that we give everybody the opportunity to speak and share and really milk all the great stuff that we have for you. So with that, I'm going to hop, skip and jump to the next speaker that we have today. And I'm just going to go ahead and introduce him. We have Onye Dikachi Ekwerike, who is an A-list mental health practitioner, a leading change agent in the mental health space, and he's been doing that for the past 7 years. He is a member of the board of directors at Behavioral Health Institute, a leading mental health organization in Nigeria. He's also the founder of Postpartum Support Network Africa, an organization aimed at raising awareness and supporting women struggling with perinatal mood and anxiety disorders in Africa. Onye Dikachi is a first-class graduate of psychology from the Lagos State University and holds a master's degree in clinical psychology from the University of Lagos. He is a 2017 Mandela Washington Fellow and a 2018 Global Leaders Fellow. So I'm going to hand over to you, Onye Dikachi.
Thank you, Oyinda. I'm delighted to be here today to talk about this very important, very, very important issue. I was only 14 years old when my... Can you all hear me?
We can hear you.
Awesome.
Yes.
I was only 14 years old when my very good friend Yetunde passed away, committed suicide, and she was the sweetest person I knew, even till this day. I remember being very confused about why she ended her own life. She was 15 years old at the time. She was 1 year older than me. The discourse around her passing was that her boyfriend had broken up with her, and so she could not deal with the hurt anymore and then thought to end her own life. Her family members, said no, that it was probably a spiritual attack. I'm from Nigeria, so we try to explain everything related to mental health and suicide as, spiritual attacks from enemies and people who might not like us. So I grew up thinking that somebody had tried to hurt her and that she was attacked by some witches or wizards who were close to her family. And I was so confused why anyone would do that, why anyone would, remotely control her and make her end her own life. And that's how I started to think about mental health challenges. I started to think about mental health challenges at that time as being caused by, evil spirits and witches and family members who might not like us. So every time I heard about suicide, my heart broke about how humans were failing humans, taking other humans' lives. And this is still the way we see mental health, for the most part where I'm from in Nigeria. Things have changed since then though, progress have been made, but people are still suffering. Today, though, we'll be looking at this whole problem of mental health and the challenges that we now face, especially during this whole global pandemic, and then how we might respond as artists, as mental health practitioners, even just individuals who understand the current realities that we live in, understanding how we can do our part to ensuring that no one suffers alone, suffers in silence. Every 40 seconds, one person commits suicide, 40 seconds. So if I pause right now for 40 seconds. That's 20 seconds. In 20 seconds, somebody would commit suicide. Around the world, 800 million people struggle with a mental health challenge. What this means is that you might know someone who might be struggling with a mental health challenge currently, or even you yourself might struggle with a mental health challenge. Depression is currently the leading cause of disability worldwide. Over 300 million people struggle with depression. 300 million people. 280 million people struggle with anxiety. The world is facing a mental health crisis. And all of these numbers were even before the pandemic. So 800 million people currently struggling with mental health challenges. 300 million people were struggling with depression. 280 million people struggling with anxiety. We already had a pandemic before COVID-19. The world is facing double pandemic, the COVID-19 and mental health as a pandemic on its own. My country, Nigeria, is even, you know, in a very, very tricky situation right now. In Nigeria, where I'm from, there are over 200 million people. According to World Bank statistics in 2018, 22% of the Nigerian population, 22% of the Nigerian population struggle with depression. You know, when I was growing up, I don't know what you've heard about Nigeria, but the only thing I knew about Nigerians when I was growing up is that we're happy people. Have you seen Kunle? Have you seen how happy Kunle is? That's the average Nigerian. We're very, you know, energetic, we're very happy, we're very positive people. So fast forward in 2018, 22% of that population struggles with depression. Now, the biggest challenge that we're facing is that there's lack of access to mental health care in my country. Currently, we have only 250 psychiatrists serving a population of 200 million people. We have only 150 clinical psychologists serving a population of 200 million people. So it does make sense then that there's a growing need, you know, to intervene in this space, to respond to the challenge of mental health in Nigeria. But like I've shown, it's not just a problem in Nigeria, it's a problem all over the world. I'm currently pursuing my doctorate degree in the US at Kansas State University. And I could tell you that just from observation, a lot of young people are struggling with depression. According to the CDC in 2018, 50% of the US population will struggle with anxiety and depression at some point in their life. 50% of the US population. The US population currently stands at 350 million people. What that means is about 150 million people in the United States struggle with a mental health challenge. So this is a global problem. From Nigeria to the United States to Brazil, people are struggling with their mental health. And the world is failing to respond to this need, this huge need that exists today. So as if the problem is not bad enough, you know, as if the mental health challenges we're facing is not bad enough, throw in COVID-19. In the United States, at least I know in the United States, we've been at home for the past 7 weeks. In Nigeria, people are currently been at home for over 5 weeks. The lockdown have only just been lifted. What we've noticed though, over the past 7 weeks, is that there's been a worsening of mental health conditions across the board. I trained for this my whole life, you know, studying about psychology, learning how to, you know, help people get through difficult periods like this. But even myself, I found myself struggling. It's not quite the same, but it's like being locked up in solitary confinement by yourself 7 weeks without human interaction. We know that we are social beings, you know, at the most basic. And so it's only normal that, you know, that we suffer when we're cut away from human interaction. Across board, there's been increase in demand for care. There's also been an increase in incidence of suicide. People are suffering, and then we must respond. But before I go into how myself as an individual and the organization I work with are currently responding to this need and what you can do as, you know, as artists to respond to this huge need, I'd like us to share, just a couple of us, you know, what are you currently doing right now to care for your own mental health at this time? Is anyone willing to share? Conley, would you keep your eyes out for individuals who raised their hand? Please, let's just get a couple shout outs about what you're currently doing to care for your mental health at this time.
I think some people are dropping things in the
messages.
Chat.
Yes.
Awesome.
Linda will help with that.
Yes. So we have Stacy, who's mentioned that she's a yoga teacher. She has a yoga teacher that teaches her online and meditates with her. Sarah Wilson McKay says exercise. I joined an origami session as well. So that's how I've been coping. We've got Jeannie. She plays music with her husband every evening. Brooke McKinney has got a Zoom check-in meeting every other week where they talk about mental health, which I think is really exciting. Please do share if that's something that's open and you have links, do drop that in as well in the chat box. So we've got more music, we have cooking, and also some nature, so a few people that are allowed outside. Anja Wales says she's planting herbs.
These are all good, you know, good things to do to cope with the current challenges that we're facing. And please, I'd like to ask that, Conley, that you please document all of these responses and that we can share with people, you know, who might not be privileged to be here today about how or what they could probably be doing to support themselves at this time. So I'm privileged myself to be part of two organizations who are really working hard to respond to the mental health needs of people, you know, at this time. The first organization that I'm part of is called Postpartum Support Network Africa. Postpartum Support Network Africa is an organization I founded in 2015 to provide support for women who struggle with perinatal mood and anxiety disorders. So postpartum depression, postpartum anxiety, postpartum psychosis. I started this organization because I had a relative who suffered postpartum psychosis. People talk about postpartum depression, but psychosis is a different beast. So she became psychotic after having a baby. And like I mentioned earlier, Nigeria's, you know, we have strong religious beliefs and everything is tied to the supernatural. So even though I come from a family that are relatively well-educated, people still attributed her disease, her illness rather, to spiritual forces. And she suffered greatly. The baby was taken away from her. You know, she just suffered really greatly. And I remember being frustrated at the time as a young, you know, clinical psychologist who was just completed his training, thinking, how can people not understand that this woman is just suffering and needs help, that she needs, you know, the help of a mental health professional? I was only 24, so my family members did not respect anything I was saying. They said, you know, I was young, I was naive, you know, that it was not about Western education. I did not know anything about what was happening. And you know what they say about prophets not being respected in their own households? Well, that was the case with me. So she suffered really greatly. And so I started this organization, then began raising awareness about postpartum depression. We go to hospitals to educate mothers about postpartum depression and anxiety, and we screen and connect them to therapists. So all the while before the pandemic, though, what we did was to go into the hospitals to screen and educate mothers, and then we schedule a one-on-one session with these mothers, you know, to help them think through or make sense of the challenges they're facing, and then recommend them to refer them to other psychiatrists if they need more help. But now with the COVID-19 situation now, it's almost impossible, you know, to meet one-on-one with these mothers. In fact, it's impossible to meet one-on-one with these mothers. So what we've done to respond is to create a virtual support group called the Warrior Mom Village. The Warrior Mom Village is basically an online platform that utilizes an existing instant messaging platform called Telegram, where these mothers are, you know, come together as a group twice every week to talk about, you know, the challenges that they're currently facing and providing support to one another. It's currently run by two therapists, you know, trained therapists, but I tell you for free, and it's designed that way, that the work is being done by the mothers. The mothers are providing support to each other. And, you know, I'm just really thankful for this platform because it's really helping them. So we're utilizing interpersonal group therapy, but our focus has honestly been on storytelling. Now, storytelling is a universal language that everyone speaks. I don't know how you were socialized, but my whole socialization process was done through storytelling. You know, everything that I know about the world was, I learned through stories that I heard from sitting on my mother's legs, you know, every evening. And so storytelling was something that we felt was culturally relevant for these women. And we adopted this as the, a means to engage them and have them share. So twice every week, mothers come together on this group and tell stories about, you know, what has been most challenging for them. And then mothers basically would talk about whether or not they could relate with it and all of that. We also encourage them to, you know, sing and dance as much as they can. So one of the things that we recently did was to invite mothers to share, you know, a song lyrics that basically spoke to them and how they were feeling at this time. So mothers who could not express themselves to tell exactly how they were feeling were able to do so using the lyrics of songs. And it was so powerful. Now, full disclosure, all I know about mental health and art, I learned from Kunle, honestly. I met Kunle in 2016. And with my training as a psychologist, I knew that there was, you know, therapeutic value in art. But I did not begin to appreciate it until he started talking about, you know, the healing power of music, the healing power of art. And we started to explore ways that, you know, myself and him could work together to ensure that mothers could get help that they need using some form of art. So we've been exploring all of that, and I'm really excited that, you know, it's helping us, you know, in the ways that we engage mothers at this time. The second organization I'm part of is called the Behavioral Health Institute. So BHI is a nonprofit organization set up to raise awareness about mental health challenges, to research, you know, mental health, to do mental health research in Nigeria. But with the pandemic too, we decided to create a support group for young adults, you know, who would be there for each other and just provide support to get through this very tough period, this very tough times that we live in. So what we do with BHI is also very similar to what we currently do with Postpartum Support Network Africa. Basically, have young people provide support to each other. But what we're doing is more of educating them. So we use CBT. If you're familiar with CBT, it's cognitive behavioral therapy. It's helping people understand the connection between thoughts, emotions and behaviors. We think that that's very fundamental, because oftentimes we an event, and it's a reason to feel anxious, true, but that's not the major reason why we're anxious. The major reason why we're anxious is because of how we are interpreting these events. It's because of our beliefs and our thoughts about the events. And so by teaching young people how to challenge, you know, irrational or negative thoughts, and then replace those thoughts with more rational and not necessarily positive thoughts, our hope is that we can help them deal better with the situation they're facing. We also utilize storytelling too. One of the things that really helped us is just a strategy, a technique by a colleague who uses a lot of photo voice. I'm trying to stay away from academic jargon, but photo voice is basically a qualitative research method used to gather information from people. And she said, you know, if we could use photo voice in the field to gather data from participants about things that matter to them, we could use photo voice to elicit responses from young people and have them talk about their challenges. So what we do is to have them, you know, post a picture on this virtual platform about a picture that resonates with them, that speaks to how they're feeling, that means a lot to them, and have them talk about the picture. And it's amazing, you know, how much they share and how therapeutic it is for them to, you know, share images and pictures that speaks to the way that they're feeling currently. And by looking at other people's images and hearing other people talk about their challenges, you know, using those photos, people are able to, you know, kind of like fill the gap that the pandemic has caused, you know, cutting off human interaction by being there for one another. So this is two ways that, I mean, we're currently in Nigeria responding to the mental health care needs of people. You know, Postpartum Support Network, as I mentioned earlier, the support group for mothers, and the tribe, the BHI tribe, which is a support group for young people to get through this tough challenge. Now, the challenges with responding to this pandemic in Nigeria and doing and having virtual support groups and online support groups, three basic things. One, poor internet. I have a privilege of being here today and connecting with you without worrying about cost of internet, because I'm in a country where, you know, internet is like air. There's easy access to it. But in Nigeria, people struggle with internet. If you want good internet, I'm curious to know how much Oyinda is currently paying for quality internet right now, all the way from Nigeria. But if you want good internet and to be able to have, you know, benefit from any online platform, you'll be paying through your nose. And many young people do not have the means to pay for good internet. And so even though they want to be part of the online support group, they have no means to get on that platform. Electricity is also a big challenge. So people would, you know, want to be at the support group, but then the batteries in their phones are dead, you know, because they've not had electricity to power their phones. Confidentiality is also a big concern. So at least 30% of people who have signed up to be part of the support groups worry that somebody might screenshot their conversations on the group, that somebody might give the link to the group to somebody else, and somebody else joins the group, and then, you know, sensitive information that they share on the platform would be divulged to like a third party. So we constantly have to remind participants about their commitments to maintaining confidentiality, that whatever is said on the tribe stays on the tribe. But we understand that this is a big challenge that we have to consistently deal with, and which is why we're thinking about more ways that we can actually create platforms that would be more secure, that would prevent people from taking screenshots, that would prevent people from sharing the links. You know, currently what we have is that, you know, we know how many people are on the platform, and if anyone joins without being directly added by an admin, you know, that they'll be taken off. Okay, so that's one way we're trying to ensure that the space is safe.
So I'm conscious of time, Kachi.
What?
I'm conscious of time.
Oh yeah, please tell me how much time do we have left?
We don't have any time left, but because I want to have at least one or two questions, if anybody has like any burning questions, I really do want. So I'll give you maybe like a minute or two to round up. And if you have any burning questions, do write it in the chat.
Awesome. So this is actually the last slide. Basically, this is my call to action to everyone who is here. At a time like this, we know that mental health care will be pushed to the back burner. It's never prioritized. So I'm calling on government, if any one of you have any connections to the government, please ensure that there's a commitment towards maternal mental health care, to mental health care. But more importantly, because, I mean, I'm speaking to an audience of arts professionals, I'm calling on you to see how can you use your arts currently to raise awareness about mental health challenges currently faced by young people and people, you know, in general all over the world. And how can you use your arts to, you know, respond to the huge need that we have now in the mental health space. So that's something for you all to think of. And I'll be happy to hear comments about how you might use your art to respond to the mental health challenges that we're facing as a world today.
Thank you so much, Kachi. That was amazing. How I met Mr. Kunle as well is that I run a mental health charity here, and we kind of got talking as well. So a very similar kind of engagement there between the two of us. I don't know if anyone has any questions. I didn't see any specific questions here. yet. And how can people sign? How can people find out a bit more about joining? Like, if we wanted, I know there are a few people in Nigeria, for instance. If we want to share more on the platforms that you've got available, how can we make that available?
So, on this current slide, there's a website there, postpartumafrica.org. You know, you can easily sign up on the website. There's a portal there that allows mothers. Anyone who's willing, who's seeking out support to sign up. For BHI too, there's a BH Institute. You could easily sign up on that website too. So if you would like to. Jenny, I see your hands up.
Yeah, I don't know if I wrote. Thank you so much for that wonderful presentation. I'm finding myself wondering about these digital spaces we're creating and the difference between creating something that's accessing people in your neighborhood or in your city versus networks that are creating conversations that are national, transnational, international. And I wonder if you've had any experience with how is therapy work differently if you're talking with mothers from one town versus all across the country versus, you know, across the world, because of course there's things about the experience of postpartum that would be similar from one place to another, but of course there's a lot of differences in the realities of people's lives from you know, one country. And so I just wonder if you've had any experience in moderating groups that are both very hyper-local versus more larger. Does that make sense as a question?
That's a very good question. So currently what we have is a group of moms who are basically Nigerians. So the group is currently not open to moms outside Nigeria. We understand that the realities are different and the challenges that is we're facing are different. So we try to keep the group that way. And so it's safe. Because we have a Facebook page where we have mothers from different parts of the countries, and it's interesting to see the difference in, you know, the experiences of moms on those pages and the challenges that they face. So currently what we have with the online support group is that it's a safe space for mothers in Nigeria, not open. We're not currently serving mothers outside Nigeria.
Okay, I have one question here just before, because we've just run out of time. Have you tried any art-related interventions for postpartum, for those, I guess, for those suffering postpartum depression?
So before the pandemic, the idea I had with Kunle was to have, you know, monthly art painting sessions with moms. So we have this brunch where moms come to, and then Tender Arts Nigeria, which is Kunle's own organization, provide art supplies. And, you know, it's a safe space for moms to share and then paint. But we've not been able to pull that off for different reasons. One, resources. Two, the pandemic that just happened. Three, finding a space for moms. I mean, a place where that activity would happen. But that's something we're currently exploring, because we do know that, you know, moms feel better when they pour their emotions into art. You know, at least from the music we're trying right now, that's proven true. But we've not been successfully able to carry out the intervention that we currently have planned out.
All right. So thank you so much, Kati. That was amazing. We are really excited about all the work that you're doing in the field. And you know, you raised a pertinent issue. Like, that many people are dealing with anxiety and depression pre-pandemic. We can't imagine what that number is right now. So I'm going to just move straight on, because I'm conscious that we are a little bit over, to Jenny Baxley Lee. I'm going to do maybe an abridged version of her bio. The rest of it you can find in the resource folders. We've sent out the link, and maybe I'll share it again in the chat. Jenny Baxley Lee serves as an assistant director, senior lecturer, and board certified dance and movement therapist with the University of Florida Center for Arts and Medicine in the College of the Arts. She's an active member of the American Dance Therapy Association. She currently has research with a focus on telehealth based dance movement therapy for veterans and their families at the Malcolm Randall VA Medical Center. As a community practice, Jenny facilitates theater and dance for health education and promotion amongst middle school and high school students in schools, juvenile justice, and other community outreach settings. She currently has a focus also including systematic review of the literature on arts practice in palliative and end-of-life care. So Jenny, we're just going to go straight over to you.
Thank you. I am so grateful to be with you all. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you, Jenny.
Thumbs up. Great. Excellent. I'm delighted to be with you. What I'd love to do as a body-based practitioner, a dance movement therapist, is first to invite us to arrive in this moment by noticing where we're sitting, taking a full deep breath in our belly, perhaps placing our feet solidly on the floor beneath us, and turning our gaze inward for a moment. I know we've been staring at screens a lot more recently. Perhaps this is part of our regular practice, perhaps it isn't. So just gently closing the eyes or softening the gaze and arriving in this moment. So I invite you into a full deep breath here. A few full breaths for grounding yourself and arriving. I invite you also to simply roll the shoulders if that feels comfortable for you. Perhaps stretching the hands from typing or moving in this way. Any movement that might feel good, the head, neck, shoulders, arms, hands, perhaps need a little stretching this morning. Beautiful. I won't take a lot of time. I think it's essential to continually greet our bodies in this way. I've been invited today to share my love of words. But in fact, my love of words exists for me in my body. I love that words capture stories. I love story songs, perhaps the best, and I love poems. And as a dance movement therapist, I rely on words to bring us back to our wholeness. So for the purpose of this session, which is entitled Healing Words, I'd like to translate the word healing to wholeness. And for me, when I define wholeness, I include our brokenness as part of our wholeness. And in a time such as we are living currently, I think that's an essential piece to ground this session together, at least for me in my definition. So allowing words to bring us back to and touch in with our wholeness in spite of the challenging times and certainly brokenness and suffering. That feels essential today. I'm going to share my screen because what I'd love to do is get us writing together. I have three poems to read throughout this presentation, but primarily what I'd love to do is write a poem together. That's my hope in the next 10 to 12 minutes. We'll see how we go. So I'm going to share my screen with a few slides to get us going. And the interactive creative writing practice that we were going to participate in today is called What's in a Question? What's in a question? So here are my slides. What's in a question? I begin with Billy Collins. And again, you may turn your gaze inward or read along, your preference. Just as the hare is zipping across the finish line, the tortoise has stopped once again by the roadside, this time to stick out his neck and nibble a bit of sweet grass, unlike the previous time when he was distracted by a bee humming in the heart of a wildflower. Since we are here today to learn together about the way words can promote our wholeness, connect us with our wholeness, it seems to me that questions have fallen out of favor. There's a real absence, especially in moments like these, of taking time for essential and meaningful questioning. And yet questions are essential to our growth and our learning. So what is the inherent value of not knowing? We know that learning is good food for the brain, and I'm going to invite us today to be an advocate for and a model of brave questions. And in this vein, I invite us to write together a poem that includes all of our best, most essential, and deepest questions. We're going to title our poem, We Were Wondering. And it's based on Pablo Neruda's final work, which is called El Libro de Preguntas, or The Book of Questions. This was published posthumously following his death. And he invites us into our own most essential questions through an entire volume dedicated to his most essential questions. In this vein, everyone has questions. We have a reservoir of unasked questions, and all good learning exchange comes down to comfort with not knowing and being brave enough to ask our questions. So how many of you have small children in your lives, especially toddlers, say a three-year-old? Our three-year-olds ask hundreds and hundreds of questions every single day. It is their way of learning and their way of discovering and finding out about the world. And yet, as we get older, we tend to ask fewer questions. This is one of my favorite poems based entirely on questions. I'll offer it now, The Summer Day by Mary Oliver. Again, I invite you, if you like, to close your eyes and receive these questions, these good words. Who made the world? Who made the swan and the black bear? Who made the grasshopper? This grasshopper, I mean, the one who has flung herself out of the grass, the one who is eating sugar out of my hand, who is moving her jaws back and forth instead of up and down, who is gazing around with her enormous and complicated eyes. Now she lifts her pale forearms and thoroughly washes her face. Now she snaps her wings open and floats away. I don't know exactly what a prayer is. I do know how to pay attention, how to fall down into the grass, how to kneel down in the grass, how to be idle and blessed, how to stroll through the fields, which is what I have been doing all day. Tell me, what else should I have done? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? Tell me. What is it you plan to do with your one wild and precious life? Look at this brave poem, this brave structure, all the deep essential questions. Who made the world? Who made the swan and the black bear? Who made the grasshopper? Doesn't everything die at last and too soon? This is Mary Oliver's work. So I invite us to wonder aloud, what are we doing on the planet? What might we do with our one wild and precious life that's different than the person next to us, different than anyone else who's ever lived before? This is from Pablo Neruda's gorgeous El Libro de Preguntas. Why didn't both of us die when my infancy died? Do you hear yellow detonations in mid-autumn? From what does the hummingbird dangle its glittering symmetry? Is four always four for everybody? Are all sevens equal? What's the name of the flower that flies from bird to bird? That's great. So these questions are just a few of an entire volume dedicated to questions. And what a beautiful final act. What a brave and beautiful final act that he was left with books of questions. So a few ideas as you write your questions. You see that Neruda treats the world as subject, as trivial and essential. So you see him playful in moments and deep and meaningful in moments. You see his use of color, of imagery, his intent to see and hear what's around him, his persistent asking. Beautiful. So I'm going to invite us now to dive into our own questions. Oh, here are a few more of his. And I'll pop back to these so you can read them as you write. But step one, because I'm in the interest of time wanting us to get writing, I invite you to write a list of questions. And just know that one or two of these may be shared, so think about whether you'd be willing to share them. Be playful with your language and subject matter, like Neruda. What questions might Neruda find in this moment in history? Let your mind roam. Consider the world with different and wondering eyes. Ask questions you always or never knew you wanted to ask. And I invite you to be brave with this. So if you have your typewriter and a screen up, I invite you to open a Word document or whatever pages, whatever document you might like. You could also use a pencil and paper, pen and paper if you have them nearby. So I invite you to be playful and write a list of questions. I'm going to pop back to Neruda's questions. Here we go. They're so good. So we'll take just a couple of minutes to write our questions this morning. And out of this will come a collaborative poem that we have collectively written. I love, how do the seasons discover it's time to change shirts? It's great. Have you ever wondered what color April is to the sick? Who's the magnolia kidding with its lemon aroma? Beautiful. So be silly, be playful, use imagery, color. Look around you. What questions do you have for the objects around you or right out your window? And in the interest of time, as you begin to write questions, if one of your questions you'd be willing to share, I invite you to pop it into the chat thread. The more questions, the better. If you have a few favorites, you can pop a few of them in the chat thread. And I'll spend a little time weaving them together and pass them back to Kunle to share with the participants. As we're writing, I'd love to invite any participant who'd love to read one or two questions out loud to us. Please feel free. Anyone out there like to share your questions? Who will be our brave first question sharer? Yes, please. Oyola.
All right. Do you want me to share?
Yes, please.
Okay. My question is, why is the year 2020 so cruel, like the raging storm?
Beautiful. Thank you, Kunle. Others, please.
Ayola. I think I saw Ayola wanted to ask a question.
Can I ask?
Yes.
Oh, you're still on mute.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Okay. I'm just wondering, if this virus didn't go, what next is the future of our children?
Beautiful. Will you say it one more time? That was excellent. Hi. Hello. Will you read it one more time? That was beautiful.
Okay. Okay. I'm just wondering, if this virus didn't go, what next is the future of our children?
Beautiful. Thank you. Others, let's hear a few more.
Hey, can I ask?
Yes.
Okay, my question is, how do I connect the rays in my mind?
Beautiful.
Thank you so much, everybody. We're gonna have to close out this session, but I think if we get the, Jenny, did you say that if we collate all the questions, we can send that to you and we can?
Yes, please. I'll weave them together and I can do it really quickly and pop it right back for the recipients that are on the call now.
Okay, perfect. So we'll get on that. And while we do that, I'll just introduce us for our next workshop speakers, facilitators. We're moving into, I think we've gone from super calm actually, and we're moving into a laughter workshop, so I hope that we get the energy up. We are fortunate to have Barbara Grabstein and Joan Akola, who are co-founders of Healing Ahead Bands. Barbara is also a global laughter ambassador, a certified laughter leader, and laughter yoga instructor. Joan Akola holds a Bachelor's of Fine Arts in Interior Design from New York Institute of Technology, as well as an associate degree from the Fashion Institute of Technology. If you want to read more about our facilitators, their bios are in the course, in the conference resource folder as well, which I'll pop into the notes. So handing over to you now.
Oh, God, these questions are so good.
Can we find Joan? And might have to put you in.
Here. How about now? Right here.
Oh, great.
I just unmuted myself. And Barbara?
Okay, perfect.
Understood. Okay. Okay, so good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. I don't know where we're talking to so many different parts of the world right now. My name is Joni Akola, and I am the co-founder and creative director of Healing Headbands Project, which is a national nonprofit organization located in New York. I want to thank Kun Lee for inviting us here today, and thanks to the Arts and Medicine for being this amazing foundation and ground for this groundbreaking event. And with time that we have, I'm gonna squeeze a lot of information together, and I just wanna hand it over to Barbara after I'm done, our co-founder, and she's gonna lead us into some very special exercises to lift our spirits after a very grounding and very relaxing time. So I'd like to start off with something that Jill Sankey shared in her keynote. We turn to the arts in challenging times because they help us to heal. And I love this because Healing Headbands began as a personal journey for both Barbara and myself. 10 years ago, Barbara and I met, we discovered that our individual gifts could help others. And Barbara being a laughter specialist and I myself as an artist, we decided to combine these gifts and create a very special project that we now bring to children in hospitals with serious illness. The workshop that we created is called the Laugh, Create, Heal Workshop. And currently this workshop is helping children, families, caregivers, and anyone who's struggling with illness all around the world. So we call ourselves, we are definitely art responders. I feel very proud of that word and coining that phrase. Kun Lee was great. Why laughter, why children, why art? This is the question. Human beings have been laughing since the dawn of time. So like storytelling, our DNA is largely responsible, essentially. Laughter is our first language, and we're hardwired to laugh just as we are hardwired to play music, to paint, to feel joy to varying degrees. Laughter is relatively a new field of science, and thankfully due to the works of Dr. Norman Cousins in the mid-1960s, he discovered that laughter builds immunity by triggering our body's natural defense mechanisms. And so when we laugh, the brain releases endorphins. We feel good. And I love this, that it's the world's cheapest painkiller, and that we all have the ability to do this. We all have the ability to laugh, and therefore we all have the ability to bring ourselves up. So, but other than endorphins, more so, there's other hormones that are released by the brain when we laugh. Serotonin is a mood stabilizer. Dopamine is a reward chemical, and oxytocin is called the love hormone. Norman Cousins also wrote extensively on the subject and outlived a life-threatening diagnosis by 25 years. Remarkable man. And also fast forward to 1995, Madan Kataria, a medical doctor from Mumbai, India, began studying the effects of laughter on health. And I'm not sure if he knew that what he was doing would start a global movement with his research on laughter as medicine. But simply put, Dr. Kataria initiated laughter sessions without telling jokes and discovered that the brain doesn't know the difference between real or fake laughter. And take a fake laughter, and within seconds, it turns into real and genuine laughter. And this movement he called laughter yoga. And if anybody's ever heard of this, but currently there are thousands of laughter clubs around the world. So why children? Well, children are our first responders. They're art responders naturally. We learn from their freedom to express themselves through laughter and art. And as adults, we kind of need a little bit more help with this act of laughter. So our workshops prove to equal out this playing field. Laughter makes us feel younger. I'd like to think so. And of course, well, why then art? Well, as we know, art heals. Art healing headbands laughs with, and this is how it works. This is how we do the workshop. Healing headbands laughs with the children for 20 minutes. It takes 20 minutes to get those happy hormones activated. And we go then right into a painting project to express the joy with color. So then we combine both of the laughter and the art in a safe, controlled environment, usually in hospitals or in special homes. And then the magic happens when we take the artwork that we created in the workshops and then transfer it onto the soft fabric in which we turn into a wearable art product. So just to give you a simple idea of what that looks like, I'm going to show you a picture so we don't have to share a screen. So the artwork is on the top, and then the little boy here on the bottom is wearing a mask. And as a first responder for this COVID crisis, this is one of the things that we're working on currently. So we are now currently developing an online workshop, working with children to respond to this world crisis as a teaching tool moving forward. So when we laugh, we pay attention, right? It opens up our brain to learning, accepting, and connecting with others. And we are seeing it more, and we're seeing it actually a lot more right now, because as we look at the media, we notice all that there's parodies in music and there's this fun projects. I mean, everybody's turning to laughter with memes on social media everywhere you look. So laughter is art. It begins with a smile, and we all have the ability to do this. And so currently right now, we're going to turn it over to Barbara, the founder of Healing Headbands, who will now lead us into part of our workshop, the laughter part of our workshop, as a laughter global ambassador. Barbara, please take it away. Thank you very much.
Can you hear me? No, I'm muted.
Unmute yourself.
Okay, there we go. Hello. Okay. Oh, there I am. I'm bigger now. Okay, so hi, I'm Barbara Grabstein. Thank you, Joni. That was a wonderful introduction, and it couldn't have explained it any better. You did a great job. Yes, I've been a laughter leader for a long time, and I believe it helped me tremendously, and I'm so glad that we have this great program that we can offer to so many. So laughter yoga is a cardio exercise, essentially. And the scientific research indicates that our bodies, as Joni said, it's our bodies that can't tell the difference between real and fake laughter, not our brains. It's conditional, meaning that sometimes we're watching something funny versus something unconditional, and we just laugh because we want to and we can, and it's great. The other thing is that there are some precautions with laughter. We're going to do some exercises today so that you can benefit from feeling really wonderful, okay? So first you have to know that you're not allowed to have any lozenges or gum in your mouth, because when we laugh, we tend to aspirate. And it's important that if you've had, I'm so nervous, I'm sorry. No major health concerns, okay? So that you can enjoy this. So what we do is we start off by clapping with our hands, because there are four methods or four reasons for laughter yoga. And they are clapping, breathing, playfulness, and then the exercises of themselves. So when we clap, we have a chant that we do. It's not religious, it's not political, and it goes like this. So you're going to clap your hands like babies, and the pressure points have to touch. We'd like them to touch. And you're going to clap and follow after me three times. And we're going to say the phrase, ho, ho, ha, ha, ha. We're going to do that three times. And at the end, we're going to raise our hands like Jolson. Okay? So, and you can clap in any way. Clap in front of you, to the side. There's no... So here we go. Yay! Now it's important to smile and to make eye contact. And since we're on Zoom, you can make eye contact with me, okay? It's kind of hard to look at everyone else in the space. I can't even see anybody else, so I'm looking at myself. All right, so as I said, it's important to make eye contact, and smiling is important. And then when we laugh, and we're looking at other people laugh, it becomes more contagious. So it just builds on the fact that it feels so good. So I'm going to start off by standing up to show you, and if you want, you can as well. The sounds of laughter start off with ho, ho, ho in the belly, like the Jolly Green Giant or Santa Claus. So if you can do that with me, go ho, 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 ho. Then if you put your hands on your heart, you're going to say, ha, ha, ha. I can't see anybody, so I'm hoping you're doing this. Ha, 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 ha. And then you put your hand on your head like this, and you're going to go, he, he, he.
He, he, he.
Oh, there we go. I hear other people. Thank you. I thought I got another voice. He, he, he. You're laughing, right? After yoga is called aloha. Because it ends in the last sound is ha. You can also do omaha, but it just doesn't have the same, it doesn't sound the same. So we're going to pretend that we're handing lays to our, I guess ourselves in the picture here, and you're just going to say aloha ha 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 ha. Ready?
One last thing.
Repeat after me and give yourselves a hug and say, we are amazing.
We are amazing.
That was a big hug. We are amazing. And we love to laugh.
Thank you so much, Barbara.
I don't know what, I feel like you actually, everybody that's gone on today has just totally shifted like the atmosphere. I don't feel like I'm in the middle of a pandemic right now. I feel like things are good. Thank you so much. Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Joan.
Yeah.
So we're going to move on. Ooh. If I ask everybody, if you're not speaking, if you could just put your phones on mute for me. Thank you. So we're going to move on to now the abstracts. We had an open call for research in the area of arts and health. And we were fortunate, we selected two abstracts which we felt that were really super cutting edge and exciting and something that we felt that the audience would be interested in. I'm going to pass over to Camelia Rodriguez-Sackbine to take it from here. Camelia, we are a little bit behind schedule, so if we go on to maybe 10:40, is that, I think that's what we'll aim to, 10:40, yeah, if that's okay.
Okay, that sounds great. Thanks so much, Oyinda. So hello again, everybody, and welcome to the research presentation portion of this conference. I'm just gonna move right along here in the interest of time. The first set of presentations we're gonna hear from is on a project called Embodied Empathy, and that is with John Henry Blatter and Jill Ware. You will see their biographies in your materials. John Blatter is an installation artist and researcher who has been exploring the themes of identity, body, and self. Currently, he is working with the Hemispherical Video and VR to create fully immersive or embodied experiences. And then Jill B. Ware is a movement artist and embodiment virtual reality researcher at Virginia Commonwealth University. She has a productive history with VCU's Art, Dance, and Choreography Department as a teacher of improvisation and other dance forms, and a long engagement as an artistic associate with Amaranth Arts, a contemporary dance company that tours nationally and internationally. So without further ado, I'd love to invite both of you, Jill and John, to take it away, and we'll just keep an eye on the clock, recognizing that there is one additional presenter after you. And we'll have some time for Q&A. And just a little reminder for everyone else, our computers and phones, thank you.
Okay, John is putting up our PowerPoint, and we'll just get started. Can everyone hear me? Just shake a hand or something. Yes. Okay, here we go. Okay, humans are easy to fool. We say this with both wonder and horror in equal measure. The rubber hand experiment shows this beautifully. The basic idea is that through simultaneous visual input, the rubber hand set in front of you with your real hand blocked from your view, along with sensory stimulation, the stroking of the fake hand and the real hand at the same time with the paintbrush, you can convince someone to adopt a rubber hand as their own fairly easily, because the brain really wants everything to make sense. It starts to believe that the rubber hand is its own. In an embodiment virtual reality experiment, you can apply the same premise as the rubber hand experiment to the whole body. And so when this person is jumping, it's because he believes that the hand that's being smacked is his own, but it's not, it's rubber. Okay, so this process is known as the body transfer illusion. And just like in the rubber hand experiment, we can use simultaneous visual input and sensory stimulation to transfer a virtual reality participant into a new body. We use hemispherical narrative video in VR goggles for the visual input and touch, smell, weight, movement, props, and human-to-human interaction for the sensory input. My name is Jill Ware. I'm a dancer, choreographer, and a retired performer and a teacher of dance. And my collaborator, John Henry Blatter, is an installation artist, trained sculptor with a practice centered around identity, body, and self. We met 5 years ago and began collaborating with technology and movement. Together, John and I formed the research project, an artistic endeavor, Embodied Empathy, to explore empathic concern, kinesthetic empathy, bias reduction, movement experiences, and arts and health collaborations. Okay, John.
So after experimenting some with it, we initially started with some of Jill's students. She was teaching Ballet One at the time, and using the embodiment to see the effects it would have on the students if they could embody and perform as a professional. And immediately we could see a quick and drastic change in sort of the quality of movement, the students' confidence, among many other things. From there, shortly after those initial experimentations, we met up with Dr. John Nessler, who I think is also in the group, and decided to do a project to see if we could use it for empathy and bias training around geriatrics for the medical school. He comes from, he was the chair of internal medicine. So initially, our hypothesis was, is if you could embody an older person, being 25 or so in medical school, if you could embody an older person, how would it affect your elder bias and your empathy towards the elderly? So the first thing we did is to find a few subject matters to work with. We ended up working with about three gentlemen out of a low-income housing that VCU Health also sort of serves. And with their help, we found three gentlemen to work with. So we spent a couple months working with them, sort of interviewing them, finding about their lives, their challenges, their thoughts, their dreams, their histories. And from that, we created embodied experiences. So what you're seeing here on the screen is from the point of view of the participant that we used. Out of the three, we narrowed it down to the one. And so everything is recorded from first person. So the hemispherical camera is one on the head in front of the eyes so that we get a view of the world. So that when the participants put on the headset, what they see is from the perspective of the person that they're embodying. Everything that they interact with, so in this case, the blood pressure cuff, as the participant has the VR headset on and is seeing their new body below them, Randy in this case, when the blood pressure cuff is put on Randy, it's also put on the participant and it's inflated and the blood pressure is taken in synchronicity to help with the body transfer illusion. So, the experience itself is sort of built out over sort of a day in the life of. So using sort of narrative and some of the experiences, we're able to sort of capture what it's like to be Randy specifically. Like not all old people, but Randy specifically, and thinking that an individualized experience is going to be more powerful and fruitful. So the study that we set up, we did a controlled study. So we recruited first year med students at the end of the year. We had 41, I think, participants, and then divided them into two groups. We had the control group and then the experimental group. The experimental group, we took measurements of empathy and elder bias, as well as the ideas of embodiment. They did the survey pre and post, and then did the VR experience. So they did a pre-survey, did the experience, and then a pulse survey to sort of see if there was any movement in any of the scales. The control group also did pre and post the same scales, but rather than the embodied VR experience, they watched the same content on a flat screen television. So no sort of like touch or interaction, just the content. And so what you're seeing on the screen now is sort of an idea of how it sort of plays out. So the circular image is what the participant with the goggles is seeing and from their perspective. And then the square image that you're seeing on the other side is the performance that's happening. So with this, we're able to sort of like recreate some of the experiences. So in the first scene, it's sort of like a getting to know. We sort of learn a little bit about Randy. And then in the second scene, which is at the health services. So he goes for a weekly checkup and sort of interacts with the students, partially I think to combat isolation and loneliness and depression, to sort of interact with younger people. He also takes a lot of classes at the university. And then from there, he meets up in a coffee shop with a friend and sort of gives a little bit more history. And then the last scene is sort of him at home, sort of finishing out his day. And so in this, we're able to add, you know, like the coloring so that the students will have to sort of orchestrate with that. He fills his pill bottles, so they have to do that in synchronicity, sort of mimicking the frustration that they have to sort of open and not being able to see. We're also looking at the body as a whole too, to how to replicate that. We are working with 25-year-olds and trying to make them feel 75. So the things that we've also done is sort of added weights to the ankles, added weights to the chest, so that it's about 15 pounds or so in a weighted vest that sort of sits on the chest. So as you sit there over the course of the 15 minutes, you become a lot more aware of your breath in the labor of breathing. In the chair that you can see the participant sitting in, we used an elastic band around their waist so that when the participant goes to stand up, we can provide resistance, so just sort of mimicking the difficulties of rising from a seated position. And that's sort of like the layout of this experience. And what we found in after looking at the data and everything is that there was a significant increase in looking at the ability to empathize and understand and relate to. What we saw in the experimental group, the VR group, was a 22% increase from baseline in their ability to sort of understand and empathize, as opposed to an 8% increase in just the narrative only. So I think it also speaks to the ability for storytelling and good storytelling, but also incorporating that with sort of the physical body transfer illusion to be able to bring the person into another's body. And I'll turn it over to Jim.
Okay, so we call the job of conducting the interactions. You can see in this photo on the right where John is holding the car door. We call these interactions for the embodied VR participant a handler. The interactions performed by the handlers are essential to our work, and the handlers often resemble a backstage old-timey crew trying to manage the timing and the tone of the physical interactions and the varied sensory inputs, as well as keeping the props ready for use at just the right moment. Timing and tone are crucial to our work so that it doesn't break that illusion of becoming another person. We have to have everything timed and perfectly, the perfect touch. Much of the handler's job is to be fully present and ready to assist the VR participant in their experience. The VR participant can't see what is going on in the real world. They can only see, feel, and sense the world we created for them. In the fall of 2018, we met a neurologist who was interested in collaborating on a VR project with us. We demoed our work for him, and at a second meeting, we collaborated on a plan. For the neurologist, it was very important to him that we work with three amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS, patients at three different stages of the disease. For us, we envisioned running all three experiences at the same time, creating a larger overarching performance or happening, so that those outside of the goggles could still engage with the work. It was also important to us that we hire dancers and pay dancers to be the handlers of those experiences. Dancers have remarkable skills of timing, precision, handling body weight, working together through movement problems, and they know how to create a heightened sense of performance. When the neurologist asked us to create these experiences, he wanted not only for the patient's family and friends to be able to experience what it is like to have ALS at these different stages, but also that these experiences be available to all of the healthcare staff where the ALS patients were being treated. Everyone from the receptionist to the physicians would be able to know what it is like to have the disease. And this resonated with us. The three patients invited us into their homes and graciously allowed us to interview them, their family, and their caregivers. From there, we began piecing, again, just like in the gerontology study, a day in each of their lives, and we asked each patient what they wanted others to know about living with ALS, what was the most important thing for us to convey through them. We fastened a 220-degree camera with a fisheye lens to their head and situated it on the bridge of their nose to capture their point of view. And that this was not the easiest of things when you have ALS to ask a patient to do that, but they were all really excited to participate and really excited to get the word out about ALS and were really, really lovely to work with. Our late-stage patient was a former nurse and getting close to the end of her life, and sadly she has passed away at this point. She wanted to have others experience her body transfer, so being moved from the bed to her wheelchair and then back to her bed and then back to the wheelchair and then back to her bed. And that's what she does all day long. And she also wanted to show spending time with her grandchildren. And so if you see in this photo, you can see this is our late stage patient, and she's being moved for the first time in the morning by a machine. You can sort of see her husband in front of her, but he can't do this all day without physical toil to him. So they have a machine that helps stand her up, and then he wheels her to her wheelchair. And so in the photo on the right, you see the dancers emulating the machine, because the machine actually didn't work. So we just made it work. we made it feel like the participant who became our late stage patient was being pulled up off of the bed and then moved to the wheelchair. This is the first night that we premiered this work. The photo on the left is our early stage patient experience. He is in many ways was the most, I think, impactful, because it was, it was a person just coming to terms with his diagnosis, and it was really an emotional experience. And then also on the photo on the right, was him in the car. Well, there's a scene where he's driving in a car. There it is. He's driving a car. And so John created a car for the VR experience. So even though, it's ridiculous, there's a steering wheel on a broom handle. in the VR experience, the person sees a real car. So they think they're actually really driving a real car. They don't see that it's just a steering wheel on a broom handle. Okay, so John, I'm gonna pass it back to you.
And John and Jill, I just wanted to jump in to say there's actually 1 minute, because we have time for the other presenters, so feel free to just kind of wrap it up and then we'll move right on. Thank you.
And so with that, we've started working with several other physicians with John's help and guidance. So this is an example. We started working with procedural surgery, so creating examples or training videos so that the students can step into the body of a professional proceduralist and be able to perform, in this case, a lumbar puncture within their simulation lab, so using it as a teaching tool. We've also are working with a behavioral therapist to look at training sessions for behavioral therapists around anxiety, patients with anxiety, and a few others are on the book. But yeah, so that's sort of where we're at.
Wonderful. Thanks so much to both of you. That is incredible technology. Big applause. And I hope you can see all the comments in the chat box. And we're going to move right on to Christos Sakaris, who is studying medicine at the University of Crete. He's affiliated with several scientific student associations and NGOs. You can read his full bio in your materials, and he's going to be telling us more about visual art and cancer advocacy in the WHO European region. So take it away, Christos. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Nice to meet you all. I was impressed by the previous presentation, and I hope that you will find my presentation and the project that is behind it a part of the interest that it had. Our project was about visual art in cancer advocacy in the WHO European region. It is a project that I carried out as a youth ambassador of the European Code Against Cancer in cooperation with Taisia Krasnova from the Bukovina State Medical University in Ukraine, who was and is till now the president of and the coordinator of the Student Artists Society. More or less, it is a multinational artistic exhibition for the European Week Against Cancer, which I will explain what is it about. What we need to know as a background, and you are all really knowledgeable about this, is that visual arts have many benefits in health, both in terms of patients' involvement and general population well-being. And they have also a very positive impact in medical education. several studies have found that they enhance the observational and communication skills of students. They diversify the skills and knowledge of future doctors, and they are also giving opportunities for self-resilience through art and culture. When it comes to the European Code Against Cancer, it is an initiative of the European Commission developed by the World Health Organization, and it is a compilation of 12 really simple instructions that can decrease the cancer risk of every individual in Europe and potentially in other areas of the world by 50% in the next few years. The European Week Against Cancer is an initiative of the Association of European Cancer Leagues, which tries to promote the code and anything related to prevention and advocacy when it comes to cancer. There is a group of youth ambassadors that I am a member of these groups, and we are organizing several activities on this. And this particular activity, an artistic exhibition, was held in the Medical Museum of the University of Crete, where I study. So the purpose of this presentation is to present you this artistic exhibition, the successes that it had, the lessons we learned, and our plans for the future. What we did is that we pitched the call and sent it over to many medical schools, medical students associations, and so on. And after that, we selected artworks. Essentially, we selected every artwork that didn't violate any rules of content or confidentiality, and so on. Fortunately, we didn't have any problem like that. And eventually, we had the European Week Against Cancer 2019 artistic exhibition. It was an event where we displayed all the artwork using a projector with a programmed presentation. This means that we had every painting presenting with a relevant description for 30 seconds in turn. And the full presentation ran like this in loop during the museum opening hours every day of the whole week, in order to attract the attention of the people working in the museum, the faculty and the students of the school, and the potential visitor of the museums. Usually schools are visiting the museum. I will show you now some of the artworks that we obtained the permission from the artists to show. The first one is the Stomach Birds. It is a painting from Vasiliki Fragiadaki, a resident of nuclear medicine from Greece, and it visualizes stomach cancer as birds. The second one is the Attempt to Rejuvenate by Taisia Krasnova, my co-author. And there is a very interesting metaphor here about how the stem cells may be useful in the treatment of cancer and the rejuvenation of people suffering from hematological cancer such as leukemia. Another interesting painting was this one from Harikle Karinyutaki, a student from the University of Crete, which visualizes pulmonary cancer and also introduces the concept of time, the concept that cancer is limiting time. And the outcome of this exhibition was that a few months later, we had the chance to publish it in a relevant call that was launched by the Public Health Panorama, the journal of the WHO Europe. It was published in English and in Russian. It can be accessed here. I guess that the presentation will be available after the conference. And there we summarized in general the procedure of the exhibition, as well as what we learned from it and what was the feedback and what can be done better or can be transferred in other contexts in the future. Leaving all this, there are some key points that we need to discuss. These are the communication of science, medical education, cancer advocacy, and of course, an assessment of our means and future considerations. The communication of science is a very interesting and vast field. ART has already a position in this field, but in times like this, we understand that we can really help people with art, and especially visual arts. In the past, it was considered that icons were the book of people who were illiterate. Nowadays, we don't have so many illiterate people, but we have many people who can't understand the complicated scientific concepts. An image, a drawing, a sketch can really help them understand principles of prevention, principles of pathophysiology, principles of pathogenesis, and help them be healthier. Medical education is a targeted part of communication of science to medical students and allied science students. And this is very important because, as mentioned in the studies, we can cultivate creativity. We can also enhance skills like observation, communication, and empathy. And this is something that we really struggle in an era of biomedical instead of psycho-biomedical medicine. Cancer advocacy is an essential pillar of the European Code Against Cancer. We try to communicate this information not only with the public, but also with policymakers, the people who can make influential moves in the game and change the lives of patients with cancer. We usually talk about the language of policymakers. For example, instead of speaking about secondary prevention, which is something complicated, this is a technical term, we talk to them about early diagnosis and treatment, which is something that can be understandable. Art is an image, and as an image, it can pass a very strong message and be perceived by anybody who has vision when it comes to visual art. Assessment. Nothing is perfect and there is always room for improvement. In our case, we in the next exhibition, and this is about the future, we're going to use some more comprehensive systems of monitoring who attended the exhibition, of taking feedback from them, communicating in the local society, and in the general community of artists globally, in order to have more visibility, more attention, more feedback, and even more improvement in the future. And speaking about the future, one pillar is the exhibition of 2020. The submissions are open. Unfortunately, this year it's only for residents of the WHO Europe region, but we are really thinking of expanding it globally in the future. That's because it is the European Week Against Cancer, but given that there will be interest from other regions, we will be very happy to open it, because cancer and advocacy and medical education are global topics, essentially. You can follow the pages of in social media of the European Code Against Cancer, the Novelmeds, and the European Student Think Tank, who are co-organizing this.
Christos, and, I'm sorry to jump in. I just want to make sure we have time for Q&A. So if you don't mind, I'm just going to interrupt right here and see. Yes. And thank you so very much for your presentation. I wanted to open it up to Q&A, and perhaps from your additional remarks, those could be addressed in the Q&A.
Of course.
We have 5 minutes, so thank you. Everyone, please feel free to share your questions for Jill, John, or Christos. I saw some comments here in the chat box. Feel free to just go ahead and verbally unmute yourselves if you have a remark or a question, and I'm looking over at the chat box myself. Jill and John, one question that Christos was starting to address was just plans for future. What are your plans for the upcoming months in terms of the technology and just harnessing it moving forward?
John, do you want to talk about the...
So it's, I guess it's something that we've struggled with over the last couple of months, because the interactions require so much like person-to-person contact. And so part of, so with the procedural surgery one, because the students were sent home, you know, and the universities were shutting down as this was getting started, a lot of them weren't able to do a lot of the simulations. So that is one place that we sort of looked at it in that we did it so that it can be used sort of on a phone, you know, or a tablet or something like that, to be able to watch it. Since they weren't gonna have the training, it was at least something that they could like visually step into and look at. And in that case, it's super helpful because you're getting like the point of view for the procedure, you know, so it's easier, like you don't have to rotate the traditional teaching when it's like face-to-face, you know, you have to rotate what's happening, like you can only see parts of it. And so this way it allows you to like save brain space so you don't have to rotate the image and switch things around. You're seeing it from a perspective. It's easier to see nuance and subtlety and a more complete picture of what's happening. So that was one way that we're moving forward with it and the type of social distancing.
Great. I see a question from Ephraim asking, can you share more about the behavioral interventions at VR? Where can I get that?
The behavioral therapy, a lot of the stuff, yeah, the week the university shut down, we had several studies that were set to start, and the behavioral therapy was one. Mm-hmm. And so we're hoping to pick that back up in the fall. Once the students resume and everything. So there's a lot of it is sort of in the development stages early on. We were hoping this spring to start doing a lot of the tests and studies for proof of concept to move forward.
Wonderful, thank you. I'm looking around in the gallery here to see if anyone has a question they want to raise their hand or share. Eustace, it was wonderful to hear more about just how you are harnessing art with your research. Okay, I see a question from Onafowakan for John. Please go ahead. I hope I pronounced your name okay. Onafowakan Ayopo? You can go ahead and unmute yourself and just feel free to take it away with your question. I'm trying to see where you are.
Hey, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, yes we can hear
can you.
Can
you hear me?
Yes.
My question is for John. I really love his presentation and the fact that he's leveraging on technology for his work. In ergonomics and industrial design and the likes and human factors, I want to ask if he has come across any research works or any applications of VR in ergonomic settings, because one of the key things about ergonomics, particularly when it comes to public building ergonomics and accessibility and the likes, is empathy, particularly for people living with special needs and with disabilities. So I want to ask, can this technology be used in the modeling process for public buildings, for public workspaces, to assess how user-friendly it is for individuals of different abilities and with different statuses? Thank you.
Did you want to take a stab, Jill?
Well, you know, I think it's, yes, I can take a stab. It's a very effective tool to show someone's world, whomever you are. And that's almost one of the problems we have. It's applicable to every person. So in the specific situation you're speaking of, in economic terms, yes. The other thing VR does really well is it gets the tone of a person across really beautifully. And so that thing that you can't quite say, but you're in a space and you kind of get a feel for this space, both proprioception, but also just like the feel of the thing, VR does really well. So in a situation where you're trying to show either the advantage or the hardship of a person, VR is an excellent place to be able to do that. Yeah, it sort of envelops you in the situation.
Wonderful. And I just want to jump in and thank all three of you only because we're at time. Thank you for the beautiful and well-expressed presentations. There's additional questions and comments here in the chat, so feel free to take a look. Christos, thank you for sharing about the open call for applications and to present. And Jill and John, that technology is phenomenal. What a way to just add to experiencing somebody else's experience and creating that empathy. So thank you so much. And I'd like to just pass it back over for the next section of the conference.
Oh, ergonomics.
So big
hands for everybody. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Christos. Thank you so much, Jill. Thank you, John. I definitely am going to probably have to spend some time stalking all the pages that have and all the information that we've got in the comment section. So just to let you know that we are going to be collating all the links as well and sharing that with you all as well. So I have the great honor, now we're moving on to just I guess formally opening our online exhibition, which is the COVID contemporary art exhibition that we co-curated myself, Ayokwo, and Kunle Adewale, in response to really what was going on. So I'll just talk you through the background. The Arts and Medicine Project has an Arts and Medicine Fellowship, and very early on, when there was a ban on meetings, we took our project onto our platform on WhatsApp, and we really just tried to engage with our fellows. So it started really as a call to our fellows, make art in response to the COVID-19 situation. And then we opened it up to the greater public. And we've been able to curate an exhibition that is basically what artists are, how artists are responding. Some of the themes that came up in the works that were presented to us are, as you can see on this wall here, themes around masks. And obviously we're now in a world where we're going to see more and more people going out wearing masks. They're the new statement, the new fashion statement. They are a new piece of skin now. So it was really important for us to capture some of the images that people were making. As you can see, my internet isn't great, so I have Mr. Kunle really helping me to direct you through the gallery space. We have a wonderful work. Mr. Kunle, let's stop. Yeah, if you just go back for me and then we can show this whole wall. So that this is how we interpreted this wall and look at the masks. We've got, if you just click onto the work for me. So we have this work by Ken Nwadiogbu, which is an amazing mix of newspaper cutouts. And it's almost like a bin liner that's over his face. And what's interesting now is that people are actually making masks out of all sorts of materials. I don't know if anyone's been seeing some of the forwards that are going around, but people are really having to interpret this mask making, and we can't just assume that people have access to the traditional masks. I really love this piece by Lolu Chabanjo, where he has the mask and the body painting mixture. The gallery, I should say, we will be sharing the link in the chat and also emailing it to everybody as well after this, the conference today. Okay, we can move around. Thank you. We go left. This is kind of like embodied empathy in that Mr. Kunle's hands are my hands at the moment. Thank you so much.
So we wanted to make sure that it was a mixture of art forms. So here you will find paintings. One of the most earliest things that were banned here in Nigeria was gatherings of people more than 50 and then more than 20, and a all-out ban on religious gatherings, which actually spoke to how serious it was, because in a country like Nigeria, and I think in general Africa, we are quite a religious people, and having a ban on things like that is really important for us to... Okay, stop. You're on mute, so it's funny. I can see that you're talking. It's...
Jesus.
Spinning around. I think it's the world of its own. So the gallery is... it has a mind of its own. That's fine. We also had a space where we wanted to have a sculptural interpretation as well. So if it does stop spinning around, you will see that we have some origami in the images there. We wanted to make sure that some of the messaging was captured in the gallery space as well. So you'll find that there's, when you move through the space, you'll see some of the messaging that's out here. And we also have this amazing wall here, which is dedicated to the health workers and frontliners, and just celebrating the amazing work that they're doing on the front line, putting themselves at risk. The space is open, so it's now fine. I now formally open the space. We will share the link and you'll be able to move through it, hopefully a little bit better than me and my VR arms. But thank you so much. Thank you. And if you were at the conference on Monday, yes, you'll know that Mr. Kunle shared a documentary, which I would say, complements the exhibition. We also have an Instagram page as well that also complements the exhibition. And you can follow us at, I believe, COVID. Let me just make sure I've got it. COVID Contemporary Arts on Instagram. So it really is a digital exhibition and a digital response to really everything, the issues that are at hand. And we've tried to make sure that it is... just covers the complete issues, complete variety of the images that we were sent over the time. Start the spinning again. Okay. Well, if you click into the works, you'll find that it gives each of the artists' names as well. Even I'm getting seasick a little bit. But thank you so much. Thank you. I know that time is definitely, I'm trying to make sure that we catch back a little bit of the time that we lost earlier. So from here, I'm going to move on to Jenny, Dr. Jenny Gubner, and let her just reflect a little bit on what we've covered maybe today, and then move on to Mr. Kunle, who will really just round up the last 3 days. So Jenny, over to you.
Thank you, Linda. Thank you, everybody. I'm aware of the time, and so I'm going to make this brief. This has been so inspiring. I'm so excited to see so many of you back each day. I feel like I've gotten to know some of you, even as tiny little squares on my screen, and I only hope that this is the beginning of something that can continue to grow in productive ways for all of us. I agree with Owinda that I felt like today each person that presented brought us into a different emotional state, and we sort of moved through, you know, grief and laughter and healing and critical thinking and imagination in all these ways that I think are so productive. I put together, in the spirit of Jenny, I took some of my notes and squished them together from how I've been writing about what you guys have presented today, and I'm just going to share those with you, and then maybe we'll open if anyone has any questions. So this is from what I learned from you all today. Everything I learned in this world, I learned through stories, sitting on my mother's legs. I rely on words to bring us back to our wholeness. In my definition, our brokenness is part of our wholeness. Children are natural art responders. We learn to express ourselves as children through laughter and art, and that laughter makes us feel younger. Yesterday, we learned children jump up and down easily. Children also today, we learned, ask all the good questions. We have so much to learn from children. We can trick ourselves into believing that our rubber hands are our own hands. Amazing. Visual art offers great tools for people who have literacy issues. Mr. Kunle's hands are my hands now. If it ever stops spinning, maybe you can slow down and take a look. Even now, I'm getting a bit seasick, but thank you all. Laughter, more laughter, always back to laughter. As creative thinkers, we have an ability to evoke powerful modes of storytelling that engage our experiences and transfer knowledge through different sensory modalities that use our eyes, our ears, our bodies, our voices, and our imaginations. These stories transform how we see, experience, and understand our world. May this be an invitation to us all. So thank you all. That's what I learned from you all today. If anyone has any other thoughts that they'd like to share, I don't really know where we are on time, Olinda, but I would love to hear any last questions for the group. I can facilitate that either by putting your name in the chat box, as always. Any last thoughts, lessons learned?
I had one question.
Yeah.
I have a question. For Joan, I think, or Barbara. It was around the yoga. I think, I remember we said the yoga was for clapping, breathing, and, oh, Barbara?
Did she, maybe she's not online?
She's on silent. So the laughter yoga is for clapping, breathing.
Yes, clapping, breathing. Just wait 1 second. Sorry.
I think that was the third one.
No, yeah. It's okay. I got it right here. Clapping, breathing, laughing, and laughing was the last one. I'm sorry.
Perfect. Thank you.
I'll get it to you. I'm sorry. I'll get it to you.
Clapping, breathing, playfulness, exercises.
There you go. Thank you. Someone takes good notes. Yay!
Thank you, TMC 187, whoever you are, wherever you are. Any last thoughts? Anything else you want to ask any of our presenters today? I think something that this conference has really showed me, Ephraim, you have something to say. Go ahead.
Thanks, Jenny. Thanks, Kunle. So this gave me energy when I thought that there is nothing art therapy going on in my country. I see that a lot of people are doing to artists a similar vision. To artist one vision, and I would propose that to the team, to the organizers, whether we have COVID or not in the future, having such kind of virtual conferences would make sense, would really make sense a lot. So I would really recommend this to happen again, whether we're staying at home or not. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thanks, Ephraim. I think that was sort of where I was going. I was going to say, I think, you know, it was funny when Kunle called me to help think up this conference, and part of me was sort of like Cheyenne yesterday saying, what do we say? What's the point? What do I have to share with all of these, you know, people in the world? And you realize so much that the lesson is that sometimes it's just the coming together of people that then allows our creative juices to flow. And I think creative people need creative people to find that solidarity and inspiration that helps push us forward, and that sometimes just getting in a room together So even if we move this forward, I can think of, you know, making more conferences that are more formal, and then also just, you know, even if it was monthly gatherings or something where we come and show up on Zoom and share ideas with each other, I think that that that's the sort of world that I want to live in and that I would love to help co-create with you all. So Oinda, I think in that, maybe in the interest of time, unless there are other, I don't think there's any more questions. So I think I can turn it back over to, or is it over to Kunle maybe?
Yes.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Jenny. Let's appreciate Jenny, everyone. Let's appreciate her. Thank you very much. We're going to be rounding up very shortly, but then before we round up, I want to invite Camelia again, who is a alumni specialist for Global Brain Health Program, which actually belongs to in the United States here, a special program for researchers, educators, policymakers, and artists, and many other people who are really interested in brain health and research. Over to you, Camelia, please.
Thanks, Kunle. Yes, this is just a quick announcement to say the Global Brain Health Institute is a one-year fellowship that's at both UC San Francisco here in California and Trinity College. It's an in-program experience. And what's really unique about it is it brings together brain health leaders from around the world who are from the arts, who are from medicine, who are from advocacy, businesses, all kinds of disciplines to spend a year together. It is paid. And each year we welcome a new cohort. So I just want to pause and invite you all to check out more. I shared a link to our homepage in the chat box. The new round of applications will be opening later this year. But if any of you are interested or would like to learn more, please check it out. Feel free to reach out to me. And I'd like to say that both Kunle, Jenny, Cheyenne, and Dominic Campbell are fellows with Global Brain Health Institute, and they're doing incredible work, as you can tell, to address dementia, to promote healthy aging, and to work globally as leaders and the kinds of leaders that you all are. We always need more talented, incredible artists. So that's just a quick call out to say that, and back over to you, Kunle.
Thank you very much.
Kunle.
Yep.
Can I just quickly say that I very much support the Global Brain Health Institute. It's another space where you can get to know amazing people, and that's, we've learned these last 3 days, is a great thing. And then also just here in Arizona, I'm starting this new program in Applied Intercultural Arts Research, and we have master's and PhD programs, and if anyone has students that might be interested in that, I would love to build this as a really international community, so please be in touch if that would be interesting to anyone. Thanks.
Jenny, please put the link for that in the bio, in the chat, if you, yeah, thank you.
All right, we are really pressed for time. Okay, so what? Good, can you all see my screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Great. So, it's been a terrific 3 days with you all, and we want to express our profound gratitude to everyone who has really made this conference a success. So this is a collage of honor that we came up with for our speakers, for our panelists, for our moderators, for the workshop facilitators, and for the team. So we want to thank Jill Shonke of the UF. I want to thank Dominic Campbell of Creative Aging. We want to thank our good friend, Stephanie Ray, of an art therapist, and also our friend, Brittany. Everyone here on this platform, on this page, on this collage, have really made a significant contribution to the success of the 3 days VCAC conference in 2020. And we also want to thank our tech people. We want to thank Mindy, we want to thank Andrew for helping us for the past 3 days to ensure that we are all here, and they have been helping us also to record all of the sessions we've been having. So we're going to be sharing the link of the day one, day two, even up to now to day three with all of you. We want to also express our profound gratitude to the leadership of the Global Brain Health Institute, GBHI, here in San Francisco. We want to thank Dr. Victor Varko and all the GBHI faculty members for supporting us to ensure that this becomes a success story. We want to thank the leadership of UF Center for Art and Medicine Program with Jill, Jishonke, Jenny, among many others, for supporting us, for ensuring that we're able to make this a success. We also want to thank the musicians, Jing and Bing, for giving us great music, and also a great friend from UF, Ricky Kanda, for giving us great music during this time. We want to thank Oyinda Fakaye, who is the director for Art and Medicine Fellowship Program 2019-2020 cohort, for being very incredible and supporting in helping to curate all of the experiences we are having today. We also want to thank all of these amazing people that I'm using my arrow to move over the surface of the screen from Ayokpo. Ayokpo has been very responsible for the graphics, all of the graphics work you're seeing on the social media, in the resource folder. This young man here is a physiotherapist, and there he's also a graphic artist. So you see the combination where the art and medicine comes in. Being a physiotherapist, also being an artist, a graphic artist. We also want to thank all of our friends, Zainab, Dr. Vivi, Babatunde, Tolulope, Casey, our moderators. We thank all of you. Camelia, our presenters for today. We thank you, John. We thank you, Jill. We thank you, our friend from Europe. We thank everyone. Without you, this wouldn't have been a success. We thank all our speakers, all our facilitators. We are very, very delighted to have all of you to be part of this experience. So this is our collage of honor to celebrate every one of you. However, without the participant experience, without all of you in this room, this program would not be a success. Without all of you that came into this program, that signed up for this program would not be, it would be an empty Zoom room. Right, you can have all of the speakers, you can have all of the facilitators, but it's just like you saying you have, I don't know how to put it, but just to put it in a way that without you coming into this room, it will just be facilitators and the moderators here in the empty room. So we want to thank all of you for participating in this conference. So moving forward, one of the things that we've been working on as a team is, because VICA is not one time experience, so it's a lifetime experience, so it's very progressive. So one of the things that myself and the team will be working on is we are going to constitute an advisory board for VICA. So look out for that, look out for an email. We're going to send you an email if you're interested in becoming an advisory board, because on a yearly basis, there's going to be a VICA experience. So this is just one of the many experiences that are coming years to come. And then also, we're also going to be reaching out to you, maybe your organization, in terms of partnership in terms of maybe providing resources or resource persons to be able to help to shape this program, because the way it is now, it's still a baby, but it's going to grow and become something very big and become very more impactful in our world. So we are very open to collaboration, just like the way UF Center for Art and Medicine have been able to help us this period of time. Also, the way GBHI has helped us, among many organizations, have been very supportive in this program. So we're going to be reaching out to you, all of you, your organizations, if you are really very interested in helping us to continue to shape this program. Also, we are creating a Facebook group. So there's a Facebook group for this program. And then it's not just limited to just 2020. So it's just a Facebook group for VICA, the Virtual International Conference for Art and Health. So for all of the experiences we've been having so far, all of the people from all over the world that we have in this room, and also people that have not been able to join us, we are going to be sharing the link of the Facebook group to all of you, where we can continue to engage, connect, collaborate on that platform, building a community of art responders in the world that we have today. So also, like I said, on that platform, many of us that are very maybe interested in facilitating maybe laughter, yoga, music, on that platform, you have all of this. We are all in the same room. And then that way you can share whatever program you are having in the time we are now, because we don't know how long this issue on ground will be. We have no idea. We don't know. In Nigeria, in India, and all over the world, we have no idea of how long this will be. But I believe that Art Responder is a very strong support system The VICA is also a very strong support system for a program like this that we are actually doing in the time that we have today. We want to thank all of you. Thank you for everything. Thank you to all the committee members in Nigeria. We thank all of you, to all our moderators, to all our speakers, to all our facilitators. Thank you for everything, for your gift of friendship, of fellowship, of collaboration, of partnership. Without you, VICA 2020 would be a failure. I also want to thank, I don't know how much I can say, but gratitude actually filled my heart, because without everyone's input here, in terms of content that has been shared, in terms of participation on this platform, this would have been a failure. But then this program is a huge success. And I also want to say that our team will be reaching out to you, sending emails to you in terms of surveys that you need to actually participate to be able to write your experience and probably be able to tell us how successful this has been. This will really help us to be able to work to, as a team on how we can improve this better. That is one. And also there will be feedback form that they will be sharing with us. There are other links that will be shared with us. And then, like I said earlier on before, day one, day two, day three of this conference is recorded. And then, so we're going to be sharing all of this with all of you. And then you can share with, within your network. So it's not limited. Don't be selfish with it. Just share abroad, share across, I mean, share to as many people as possible. So I don't know how much to say. I don't know what to say again. But I would like to ask Mindy. Mindy, yeah. I'm glad Mindy is back on the platform. Mindy will like you, yes. Mindy is a wonderful faculty member from here and the Global Brain Health to just cap this event today. Please, thank you. Welcome, Mindy, everyone.
Thank you, Kunle. You're so kind. I was so glad to be a part of this. So thank you. And what a fantastic couple of days to meet all of you and see all the things you had to say. So it's my pleasure to be here.
All right, great. So thank you, everyone. We're going to be sharing with you the link for the virtual art gallery that we just opened today. The link that was shared in the chat box is not accessible yet. So about within 10, 20 minutes, we'll be able to fix that and share that with you. And then you can share it within your network. You can share it with your friends, and then they can go online and navigate and enjoy this 3D art exhibition, which is the collection of the COVID-19 art experience from all over the world, including Nigeria too. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We're going to be sending the link to VICA Facebook page, a group page, to all of you. And then you can also invite your friends who were not part of VICA experience to actually join that particular Facebook group, because we are art responders community at the time we find ourselves. And then we have a good relationship now, and this relationship will last longer than the way it is now. God preserving our life. We love you. We appreciate you. We want to thank all the team members of Art and Medicine Project. Thank you very much, all the team members of Art and Medicine Fellowship.
Thank you, Mr. Kule. Thank you, Mindy.
Good job.
Thank you, everyone. Yeah.
Thank you. Good job. We love you. Should I play music? What music?
Congratulations.
Oh, Mr. Kule, that would be nice.
Should I play one music before we leave? Yeah.
Let me play one.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kule. Thank you, Joan. Speakers,
please.
Thumbs up.
Please mute everyone.
Can you please mute? Can you mute your speakers then?
Because I haven't heard from you in a long time.
A long time, like a day?
No, we have.
Mr. Kunle, you are muted as well, so you're going to have to unmute. All right, Mr. Kule, you need, yeah, huh? Perfect.
Yeah, so we can sing together anyway. So make sure you dance and you move your body.
Place for our children. They know it's a better way. They can make it a better place.
Okay, move your body. Everyone, come on.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. A place that's brighter than tomorrow. And if you really try, you'll find there's no need to cry. It's a place where there's no hurt or sorrow. There are ways to get there. If you care enough for the living, make a little space. Make a better place. Heal the world.
Make it a better place. For you and for me.
Yeah, for you and for me.
My young one.
Existing and start living. And if
it's
better, make a better world.
Make a better world.
Make it a better place.
Move your body.
That's my face piece now. Yeah, I don't like face piece, so I don't do it. I don't make it. When it comes to good food, like any good food.
You are for me.
Love sign, everyone, love. Love for me. Yeah, love her. Woo! You love Thank you guys. Have a great
weekend. Love you guys. You're amazing.
Hi everybody.
Thank you.
Hi everyone.
Thanks everyone.
Bye everyone.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Bye. Bye. I miss you.
I'm gonna miss everybody. Thanks so much. Please fill out the evaluations.
Beautiful.
Thank you guys, you're amazing.
Hey, yeah. I love you all.
Thanks, Ephraim. We're gonna partner with you.
Amazing, so thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Yeah.
Yeah, bye. Okay, I'm building. Bye.